Hi, my name is Marcel, and in today's video I will be talking about the history of surfing. I'll be touching on the origins of it, how it came to be. I will talk about how it was popularized. I will give a brief overview of the evolution of the surfboard over the last century. And finally, I intend to touch on the impact it had on popular culture. So if we look at the origins of surfing, many people think that it originated in California. However, this is a misconception. It more likely originated in Hawaii, since it has been practiced there for about a millennia by the natives there. Now, if we look at ancient Peru, this may come to as a surprise to many surfers, but there it is said to have been practiced for thousands of years, and it is unknown in what capacity this was done. What we do know is that most likely surfers or whatever, however we want to term them, wave riders in Peru rode on so-called caballitos. Now, these were crafts composed of reeds, sort of in the shape of a canoe, or a kayak. They were 12 feet in length, 2 feet wide, and had a weight of about 90 pounds. They're said to have been used for fishing purposes, and in fact, to this day, they are used for fishing purposes. It is unknown whether or not they were also put to use simply for recreational purposes. Now, if surfing in this form prevailed in Peru thousands of years ago, was it then responsible for Hawaiian surfing? Well, from what we know, the Pacific Ocean was colonized west to east. So from Polynesia, from Indonesia, out to Polynesia, and then to Hawaii. So it's very unlikely that, and we know this from genetic studies, that Peruvian surfing is responsible for Hawaiian surfing. Rather, we should view it more as a separate, self-contained prelude to what we know as surfing today. In ancient Hawaii, surfing was very much a women's sport, but to tell the truth, it was a sport for the masses. Just like every American in today's culture owns a vehicle, so did Hawaiians own a surfboard. Now, surfing in ancient Hawaii was very closely tied to sex, and you can imagine, a pair or a couple surfing, having fun in the waves for hours, and then, getting naked afterwards. Competitions in Hawaii, in surfing competitions, large sums of resources were put on the line. Competitors would sometimes even bet their lives on winning the competition. So it could actually escalate to a life and death thing. This is also similar to how surfing in Hawaii was very closely tied with their general culture, even with religion. So it definitely affected all levels of society. Kings and queens surfed the most, and they had the most luxurious surfboards. They were hand constructed by professionals for them. So it was a very big deal back in ancient Hawaii. Now, the sport through colonization, and the colonizers were very pious people. They actually discouraged Hawaiians from practicing their sport. And at one point, probably around the 1890s, the number of surfers worldwide was probably around a few hundred people. But then in the 1900s, through clubs, surf clubs founded in Waikiki, surfing was re-popularized. It was revived, and from that point on, it spread to different areas in the world. So, three examples that are demonstrative of this is are George Freeth, who was a man who spread the sport to California. He arrived in the early 1900s to San Francisco, and then after realizing how cold the water was, he actually went down to LA. And at that time, he thought that he had been the first person to surf continental America. This is, in fact, is not true, because two Hawaiian princes, the Pīkoi princes, had already done so in the late 1800s. George Freeth, held surfing demonstrations in LA, and of course, LA, being the city that it was at the time, would suck anything up that was new and rad. So that definitely was one of the most important moments in creating or inspiring Californian surfing. Now, these two princes that I have mentioned, the Pīkoi princes, who were Hawaiian, spread surfing to the United Kingdom. They held a surfing demonstration there in the late 1800s. However, surfing actually only got popular in Europe about 60 or 70 years later. Now, Duke Kahanamoku was responsible for spreading surfing, at least on a major scale, to Australia. And when he traveled there in 1914, he held many surfing demonstrations in Sydney and other places as well. And he definitely, although Australia was not completely new to surfing, only through him did it really catch on. If we look at the evolution of the surfboard, let's imagine the first surfboard being the Olo. Let's take that as the first surfboard. That at least was the case in 1900. That was like the traditional surfboard go-to. It was about 15 foot, 12 to 15 foot, pretty narrow, and very heavy, composed, of balsa wood, or wet redwood. These boards were massive, sort of clunky, and then the boards slowly improved. Duke Kahanamoku's 1910 board was far lighter, and then it progressed. Boards became chambered. They used more efficient materials. One of the gentlemen that played a very big part in this was Tom Blake, also Simmons, a Californian surfer. Was responsible for many an innovation in this regard. And then if we look at the latter part of the 20th century, we see boards that are short, much shorter, and even somewhat narrower. But most importantly, they have a more extreme rocker. Now, rocker is responsible for essentially how well the board sticks to the wave. So you can try this actually. This is a cool experiment. You take a spoon, I don't have a spoon here right now, and you hold it under tap. It will actually be pulled by the stream of water towards it. So the stream of water, if you hold it the right way, then the spoon will actually stay in one position just like so. Now, if you turn that spoon around and you put you essentially try to grab the water with that spoon, it will be repelled by the water. And that's the idea. You want to create a curve with your board that makes it stick to the wave face. And this is what shortboards achieve. Today's shortboards, even shortboards from 30 years ago, they have a more extreme rocker than a traditional Olo, which is pretty much straight. Now, these traditional longboard type surfboards are really good for smaller waves, Santa Cruz type waves, and shortboards with a more extreme rocker are more suited to big waves or bigger waves, more steep waves. Okay, so the last segment of my presentation is surf culture. We're talking music and movies. These two areas are of importance to us today. There are two genres of surf music. There's instrumental surf, think Dick Dale, and vocal surf. An example would be the Beach Boys. And one of the greatest impacts that surfing had on media or on movies was the appearance of Gidget around 1960. So this is a story of a Californian surfer girl who's called Gidget because she's kind of short. So it's a play on words, you know, you have girl and midget, that's combined. And this movie became extremely popular, having been translated to many a language, including Hebrew and Japanese. And it was what really kindled an enormous spike in the surfing population. In 1960, a few thousand surfers in Australia, California, and Hawaii actually practiced the sport. Around 1970, you're talking more like a few million. And so it spread all around the globe, including to Europe and Japan. So that was my presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks a lot for listening till the end. Thank you. Till next time. Come with me for fun in my bargain. Jump back up.